to the neighborhood forum for Ward 5. So we're looking forward to a good evening of dialogue and conversation. I want to take a quick minute to introduce our panel, and then so everyone knows we are recording the meeting tonight. For panelists, these microphones are for the recording, but I am going to hand it. We do want to use these microphones when we're talking so that everyone here can hear what you're saying, okay? All right, great. So this is for Ward 5, as we mentioned, and this is the fifth in the series of these neighborhood forums that the committee has hosted. I'm going to get into that in a second. I want to introduce our panelists. So we've got Public Works Director Peter Rice, Deputy City Manager Nancy Colbert-Puff, Mayor Jack Blaylock,
hello,
City Councilor Nancy Pearson, Fire Chief Steve Achilles, and Police Chief Bob Murner. This is his first neighborhood forum, so welcome, Chief.
Good luck. Go easy on me.
Exactly. All right, so real quick about us. So some of you have probably been to neighborhood committee meetings before. If you haven't, we are a mayoral blue ribbon committee, and our charge is to advocate on behalf of all neighborhoods in the city. Our steering committee is made up of those individuals here, and I think most of us are here tonight. So Kathy Bergeron, the vice chair, is out here. Christy Cardoso, I know, is here and was chair of the committee for many years. Paul Mannell is here, and I don't know if I saw Larry here, and Marie, has Marie made it yet? I think she was coming. And then our city council rep is Assistant Mayor Jim Splain, who has served on the neighborhood committee years ago himself. And just real quick, things that we've worked on in the city over the last number of years. So, you know, various issues we will address. A lot of them the last few years have been about CIP, so capital improvements for neighborhoods. We worked with the city in the last couple of years to introduce a way for citizens to introduce capital improvement projects of their own. And I believe for this cycle, there's a couple more days that people can submit them. I believe
right.
It's the 13th.
Yep, I think
yeah.
So
that's on the website in the capital improvement area where, you know, citizen can, you can find a form and submit a suggestion for a capital improvement project that you want considered on the plan. We also work with the city to do things to kind of help make that process clearer for neighborhoods and residents. So CIP 101, they've done a couple times, things like that. And then we, every August, the National Night Out event is an event that we organize with the police department. So we typically have at least 20 neighborhoods that take part in that event. And then we had worked with the mayor and the council last year to talk about ways to identify a city councilor who could be a liaison and a contact for each ward. Because as you know, all our councilors are elected at large. So that's something that we worked on last year. And then finally, these neighborhood forums that we did, the goal was to, through the course of about a year and a half in the two-year cycle, have an event like this for each of the five wards. So last June of 2016, we started Ward 3, and we've done them in 1, 2, and 4 since. So this is the final of that cycle. And it was an experiment to start with and see how it went. I think so far it's gone well, and we would entertain the idea of starting another cycle perhaps in the middle of next year. All right, so I think, oh, and we did do one of the state reps, a similar forum last year as well. So I think that's it for my intro. We got a couple other introductory comments that we want to do, and then a presentation regarding public works and a bit of an update on the wastewater plant. And then the goal is to have as much time as possible for Q&A. And what we do would like to do is wrap up that by about 7:30 and leave some time towards the end where people can talk directly with everyone on the panel. Okay? So let's start down here on the end. Chief Achilles, you had some comments you wanted to share about the fire department.
Sure. Let me use that one.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening, everybody. You got that?
Oh, yeah. So I'm Steve Achilles. I'm your fire chief. I've been in the city for 17 years, and I live out in Elwin Park. My wife works for the school department, so to us, this is our hometown. This is where our kids went to school and graduated high school. Now they're off in different parts of the country. But it's always a good opportunity to talk to the people we serve, especially the residents, on what we do and how we do things. And just for all of you to know, that your fire station that serves the ward downtown is the one on Court Street. One of our older fire stations. It was built in 1919. And we also have two other fire stations. One is on Lafayette Road, down in the south end, if you will, the other south end. And then there's one out on the trade port. Actually, the one in the trade port is getting renovated. It was built in 1950s as a fire station for the Air Force. So we had to make it a little bit bigger to fit modern fire apparatus and a little more appropriate for the workforce that is out there. On duty at any one time, there are 14 firefighters in the three stations. And one of the fire chiefs, myself, or one of the deputy chiefs, are on call 24 hours a day. So often if there's an emergency after hours or a substantial event, one of the, myself or one of the deputies will show up too. There's a fire engine and an ambulance out of the downtown station. There's a ladder truck and an ambulance out of the south end station, and there's an engine out at Pease. For Ward 5, this is our busiest fire station, which sort of makes sense. The population, a lot of the special occupancies that are downtown, and that fire station goes as far as Sagamore Creek and McDonald's, goes to Foy's Corner, goes up Woodbury Ave quite a bit, and also goes out to the Plains ball field just a little beyond that. So it's a rather large district, but our goal, and this is, I think, kind of the focus of what I like to talk about, is your fire department provides you two things. We don't make anything. It's probably a good idea. But our product is time and people. So if you have any kind of emergency, what's important is we get there fast. And often, some people, it's not fast enough, but our goal is to be anywhere in the city, no matter what the problem is, something's on scene within 7 to 8 minutes, no matter what time of day or night. That is the goal, and that's why the stations are where they're located. Now, this one of our other resources is people. It's important to solve a lot of our problems, not with just one or two people, but the more complex emergencies or requests take multiple people. And we're finding the complexity of the calls or types of emergencies in the city are getting more complex and requiring more resources to fix it. So your fire department is staffed right now to be in anywhere in the city within 7 or 8 minutes and respond the right amount of people. And that will be our challenge going forward with kind of the popular growth and the economic vitality that we're seeing, is that's going to be a challenge for us over a little bit of time. And I'll end with a couple things. One, if you want to know why we do certain things, we have a document on our website. If you go to the new city's website, go to fire department, and under resources, there's a thing that's called reports and statistics. You'll see standard of cover document. Why we do things. Why do we send two fire trucks to this, an ambulance and a fire truck to that? Why do we staff? And the other document is how we do things, and what do we look to do forward is our self-assessment on department operations. So they're not fun reads, but they're academic reads that will tell you why we do things and how we do things. And as we move forward in the budget year and in upcoming years, those are our guiding documents to tell us really why and how we need to respond and be responsive to the needs of the community. So I'll be around for a little while. So if there's questions afterwards, I'll be very happy to answer those questions. But thank you, and I'll pass it over to Chief Murner.
Thank you, Chief Gillies.
Good evening. And I've been here, I've been here now 3.5 months. So I'm still part of the learning curve, but just a couple of things that I can just give you a general overview of what we're working on, and then I'd be happy at any point to answer questions. So First off, there's a, we initiated the evaluation project in January of 17. Officers were being evaluated monthly, and after the first 6 months, we moved that to 3 months. So for instance, in a month, officers are working, they work 10-hour days per week. So that gives you, if they happen to be off for 2 weeks, that means you're evaluating them basically on 8 tours. It was kind of redundant for the, not only for the officers, but the supervisors. So today, I signed 3 evaluations today. If you were hired in February 1 of 2016, your 1 year evaluation is done to February. It's done from your hire date, so not everybody's done at the same time, which kind of spreads it out. We have delved into the CALEA accreditation process. It started under Chief Mara. We're continuing to move forward. And just to give you an idea of where we are, it's a 3-year process. We're about a year and a half into it. They anticipated that it would be 2 years before we would be applying for initial compliance. We anticipate applying by May or June of next year at the latest. So right now, 85% of our policies are CALEA compliant, 14% are in progress, and 1% are waiting review. So that means that 85% of, the credit goes to Lieutenant Darren Sargent and Jackie Burnett, who was the CALEA accreditation person that was hired. Tireless work, rewriting policies going all the way back to the 1940s and 50s and bringing them up to snuff that are, and it's not only that we rewrite the policies and they get approved, but there's a series of proofs that have to be adopted with every single policy that's done. So they have to, you not only show that this is what the policy is, there's a 3-year process of giving proof that not only is this the policy, but that's what you're actually doing on a daily basis. And all of the statistics are kept. It's being judged by CALEA, which is an outside accreditation, which is nationally known. I've personally met with the regional director twice now, Paul McMillan, who was the former chief of the MBTA police in Massachusetts. He's a very serious man, but the CALEA process is really moving along well. And they've actually, as Lieutenant Sargent and Jackie go to some of these regional meetings, they're stealing ideas that our team has put together. Which is a compliment. Some of the graphs and charts and matrices that allow us to show those proofs. From an enforcement level, I know traffic is a massive concern. I can tell you that about 75% of the phone calls, emails, and text messages, snail mail, whatever it is, that I get into my office are traffic related. Now that can be anything from pedestrian crosswalk traffic to speeding cars to motorcycle noise across the board. And I'm not gonna bore you with a lot of statistics, but just to give you an idea on motor vehicle stops. In 2016, Portsmouth Police stopped 7,743 cars. In 2017, we've stopped 12,671 cars. So, and then I'll get into the actual citations. Many of those stops involve giving a written warning, but that written warning is documented into the computer. So if we stop someone a second time and we see that they were just stopped recently, or they're in the written warning database, then they're not gonna get the option again of the discretion of the officer. And just to give you a quick idea of the last 5 years, so in 2013, the Portsmouth Police issued 242 citations. In 2013, 242. 2014, 212. 2015, 200. 2016, 383. And in 2017, we've cited 1,671 people on moving violations. So that's an increase of, I know we have some math people here, but I think it's like 64% or something like that. So the officers are stopping the vehicles and the persons that are the serious violators. Now, I can tell you that that doesn't change, but the locations where we're putting the officers are where I'm receiving the community complaints. I did the walk with a cop this morning, and you know, I had a couple of residents come up to me, mothers that were in the park with their kids, giving me specific locations, and we go right into the shift commander's office to address it. Now, besides those 1,671 citations that have been issued, to date, we've made an additional, which don't come up as a citation because the arrest takes priority. We've made over 300 arrests since January that are related to motor vehicle stops. So if you put the two items together, we're about 1,900 stops that have resulted in either a money fine or an arrest. I think the importance of the arrest ones are those are generally offenses where people are operating after suspension, operating under the influence, narcotics in the car, any a myriad of other motor vehicles. So that also tells me that the officers are stopping the right people. If you're stopping someone for a move-in violation, they have outstanding warrants, they have drug charges pending or something like that, then we're stopping the right people. That's to date. To give you just a quick idea of how busy it's gotten in your city, my city, in 2016, we register everything as a call for service. So when someone calls 911, any type of an emergency call, and or if the officer calls off and says, take me off with this vehicle at such and such a location, take me off on a property check. 2016, from January 1 until October 10, I think we got it right up to today, 31,427 calls for service. 2017, 41,676 calls for service. So we're 10,000 plus calls for service with the exact number of officers that we had in the prior year. Of those, and this is, I think, one of the most important thing about the changes that began with Chief Mara and I've continued, more than 5,000 of those are self-initiated, either motor vehicle stops, building checks, which means the officers are taking certain amount of initiative and going out there. But with the increase in population, with the summers and the like, the calls for service and the frequency of self-initiated stops by the police have increased by over 10,000 already this year. The last two things I'll just talk about quickly. You've all seen the articles on motorcycle noise. It was brought up at one of our police commission meetings. I spoke on it, and New Hampshire One picked up, and Captain Warkol spoke on it just recently. And if you want some really interesting reading, go to the comments section there, because we're about 50-50 where people absolutely hate us and they've said some fantastic things about us, and people that absolutely love the fact that we're looking at the motorcycle noise. But just so you know, we've got a training coming up with two of the state troopers that do the training. I'm not gonna, in years past, apparently they used the state police to come out with us and use their equipment. We're purchasing three pieces of equipment, not very expensive, noise meters, anemometers for the wind resistance, etc., and we're going to put a number of officers through the training in-house so that we can handle the motorcycle issue ourselves. I mentioned at the police commission meeting that would be up and running fully in the spring, and the commission kind of chided me, but I wanted to make sure that we're doing it right. And it's the same thing with our moving violations. Our radar equipment is calibrated every day, so you can't just say, okay, this is what it is, because they're going to get challenged, much like our, you know, breathalyzers and things like that. It has to be calibrated, so what you're actually saying people are doing for speeding goes. A number of the locations that we've dealt with traffic, we've set the radar car up because someone says everybody's speeding, everybody's going down the street 45-50 miles an hour. We've set the radar car up and attached it to the database, and it records every single car that goes down the street. And the officers, so for instance, on a recent street, and we'll be presenting this at a commission meeting coming up, we did about 50 cars and there was only one car that was more than 9 miles an hour over the speed limit. Now, that can be depend on the time of day. If you're 9 miles over the speed limit when the school buses are going in and coming out, it's a big deal. Last thing is our opiate-related incidents here. As you know, it was an article in the New York Times just a couple of days ago, and last night in listening to 68 RKO, Howie Carr had the New Hampshire State Medical Examiner on, who just resigned, trying to do something else. But they're talking about the backlog of opiate-related deaths in the state of New Hampshire. It's not germane to New Hampshire, I can tell you that. I just did 2.5 years out in Seattle, Washington, and our bicycle offices in the downtown section were using Narcan 6 to 7 times a day. So, but like everything else, the medical examiner talked about things where they're doing autopsies. We have to get the toxicology back. It takes time. If we're going to be charging people for carfentanil or fentanyl or sales of such, they're to the point where the medical examiner in New Hampshire was on the verge of losing their accreditation, because by their accreditation standards, they're not supposed to be doing that many autopsies in whatever the set period is. By the same token, I know, and I can speak for Chief Achilles, because we've talked about this many times, his firefighters and paramedics are responding to these same things, as are our officers. They're time-consuming. They require a little bit more investigation. They require a lot of work of your fire department. So we're working not only from an enforcement end. We have a detective assigned over at the DEA. I met today with Mike Gibley, who is the resident agent of the FBI, and they're going to be doing some work with us on the same type of opiate-related trafficking, bigger cases. Our offices, I just brought back one of our most seasoned drug detectives from the DEA, put a new officer over there to be trained so that we can concentrate on Portsmouth first, and that's kind of been the way that I've done business. We've also worked very closely with Safe Harbor, and we're working with some of the other social service providers to try to, because we're not going to arrest our way out of that problem. But it's taking an inordinate amount of time of the offices. It's a lot of our increase in calls that are related to opiate deaths and so on. Just on the last, give you an idea of some of the things that we've done. Just recently, I was, during the summer, there was a pub crawl that we have a couple of our detectives monitoring social media, and I got some calls from residents and some emails from residents where there was supposed to be 1,200 people coming to Portsmouth for a pub crawl on a Saturday in the middle of August, I think it was. So most of the establishments are pretty busy downtown to begin with, and now you add 1,200 people. I went around and I met with 8 of the establishments were in Portsmouth, 1 was in Kittery. I went around and I met with each and every one of the establishments. I would only speak with either a manager or an owner of the establishment, talk to them about the partnership that they need to have not only with the police but with city residents, what's expected of them, over-serving, making sure just because someone has one of the pub crawl bracelets on that, we still doing identifications. Met very well by the merchants. I then spent the day in town. I think some people thought I was on the pub crawl. I was ready at the end, but I went to all of the places in the mid-afternoon and then went back around 9 o'clock at night in plain clothes, walking. Everybody was very, very responsible merchants in town, just fantastic. From the community aspect, as you've seen, we've done the walk with the cop. We've done many of the senior citizens. I see Harold there. We've done many of the dinners at Living Innovations. Working with our seniors. This morning we had about 30-odd people at Walk with a Cop, both mostly seniors and folks from Living Innovations. You probably saw, Mayor Blaylock was the MC at the tricycle race, and my wife thought it was the worst picture she's ever seen of me in her entire life. They put the helmet on me backwards, I'm sure. And then just this past Saturday, we put a team in the tank pull down at P Peas, which was a fundraiser for the families of veterans that are deployed right now. Just on the narcotics and the opiate-related stuff, the last thing that I'll talk about, and then I can open for questions. We have, I met with Chief Achilles. We met with a company that was selling a lot of these personal protective equipment kits, which consist of Tyvek suits, 1.5 milliliter heavy rubber gloves, booties, masks, et cetera, because first and foremost, our first responders, and we depend a lot on the fire department because they're the biohazard-trained experts, but usually by the time our first two officers get in the door, they realize they're in a bad situation, but so that no one else responds with that. And we're doing all of the things to protect not only our officers, and then we're well on our way towards Narcan so that we can do reversals as necessary. We're only hamstrung right now by the state standards, which they're still working out some of their rules and regulations. And that's a nutshell.
So. Okay, thank you, Chief. Yeah, we're gonna hang on for questions so we do one more presentation. I think you failed to mention that you did defend your taco eating championship.
Yes,
so
they did.
And Chief Achilles, your team has some work to do with the tacos. Thank you. I do, before we get into the public works, want to recognize a couple other city staff who are with us and going to do some contributions tonight. So we have Assistant City Manager David Moore with us, and we have City Engineer Terry Damaris also. And I think Terry will be taking part in this next piece regarding public works.
Thanks, Cliff. My name is Peter Rice. I'm the Director of Public Works. This evening, just a brief presentation on a couple things in terms of the Department of Public Works. First, I'd like to reinforce the Portsmouth Click and Fix, which is a new means of, it's actually not new, really, it's over a year old, but a means of accessing our work order system in the Department of Public Works, and I'll speak briefly to that. I'll talk a little bit about the current and pending projects, how to access our traffic calming process. I know there's many folks that are very interested, and there's been some initiatives to do improvements to the streets and improve traffic. The chief spoke at length about their efforts. We work very closely with the police department, as well as the fire department and the planning department, to address the concerns relative to traffic speeds, volumes, and the like. So it's something that, you know, we are aware of and we're working hard at, and there's a number of people that we've throughout the residency that we've been working with, and it's been a very rewarding. And then finally, the something that people have been very interested in is the neighborhood parking program, which we're working on, and I'll talk briefly to that as well. Just a quick rundown of the projects that we're looking at. I'm sorry, the click and fix process, as you may know, is a means of accessing our public works work order system. You can get to it in two ways. Through an app on your phone. If you have smartphones, you can go to the city's website and get through it there. The other way of doing it is just calling up the Department of Public Works, 427-1530, and you can go ahead and get your requests done through that as well. What we do now is we enter all that information into our database so that we can better track the requests and better respond to them. I know people get frustrated. At times, they feel they do the click and fix, and they don't get a response they want. And we try to respond to that as quickly as possible. And at times, they're not necessarily work order related requests. Sometimes they're more capital type requests, or they're more city policy type requests. And at those times, we try to give a more descriptive response than just it's completed or something like that. But I can't say we have 100% satisfaction all the time, but it is something that we're working on, and your feedback on this is really important. So don't give up on it. Continue to use it, and we get good information out of it, and we'll better be able to serve you by being able to do that. So as I said, it allows the city to collect more information relative to the requests. It allows us to better allocate resources, and it gives the city council a metric for them to make policy decisions and funding decisions so that we can explain to them how much requests we have for additional garbage pickup or how much we have snow complaints or how much we have these things. And it helps us support our requests for those types of activities to better serve you. just to speak briefly to the projects in Ward 5. The most recent project we completed is the tennis courts, which I'm very happy how they came out. We're going to be doing a lighting upgrade at Leary Field. The lights there are failing, as well as at the high school. Ward 5 actually expands all the way up to the high school. It goes down all along Sagamore Creek and wraps around the water down to Daniel Street and Congress and comes back a little bit of middle up court. And it's an interesting ward in that it captures a lot of different neighborhoods and a lot of different areas. So there's a number of projects here that you may say, well, that's not my neighborhood, but it's part of your ward. It's part of the larger area. So we have the City Hall facade project. The north facade of the City Hall is a brick facade that's peeling away from the building, and that needs to be replaced. The Lafayette Road pumping station, which you may see, is currently under construction. It's being rebuilt. The Memorial Bridge parking lot was paved this summer. Mechanic Street, the old Snappy LaCava property, there's a dock down there that's it's literally collapsing into the water. We're in design to replace that. There will be a larger master planning process for that whole property in there, and that'll have public input and public process. But in the near term, we need to stabilize that dock, remove it, and get it replaced so that we're able to keep it from falling into the river. And then Terry will speak after on the Pierce Line Wastewater Treatment Plant, the status of that. We also have a section of Fleet Street that is in Ward 5. Andrew Jarvis intersection, which is the intersection leading into the high school, which is in design and will be replaced with a signalized intersection this coming summer. That'll have a right turn lane coming out as well as a right turn lane coming in, and it should improve the safety significantly and allow people to get in and out of that area during peak demands. And that's something that I'm very excited about moving forward with. The Chestnut Street project, which is currently underway, is in Ward 5. The Sagamore Creek master plan, which has been ongoing, and David Moore can speak to that if there are questions later. And then the Pierce Island Bridge Force Main project, which has been ongoing forever. And Terry can speak to that as well. So traffic calming is something that everybody is very concerned about. We hear this a lot. As the chief said, you know, a lot of his complaints are people concerned about traffic. And we've been working very closely with the other departments as well as planning to come up with a means for residents to access a traffic calming process in a more predictable manner. We've worked with PS21 as well to do what they call tactical urbanism. I like to call it Street Lab. And what that is to allow for experiments and pilots. And it's been a very innovative and really positive means of being able to get more involvement with the residents in trying to improve that. But right after the initial request for a traffic calming type of thing, the Department of Public Works staff, Eric Eby, our transportation engineer, goes out and starts collecting the data. If we don't have speed data, if we don't have traffic turning movements and things like that, he literally puts up radar cameras, radar sensors and cameras to document what is actually happening at these areas. As the chief knows, public perception often is that the speeds are really fast all the time. And oftentimes the speeds are fast, but not all the time. There are peak times, and there are things that are happening that are causing people to speed up. And so the information that's collected is used to try to come up with solutions. So the first types of things that we look at is, you know, what are non-capital measures that can be made? And then if non-capital, which are simple solutions, can't be done, we look at more the more capital-intensive measures that can be done to calm traffic. The non-capital types of things, which are really as part of our operations budget, include street signs, speed indicator signs, enforcement, which we work closely with the police department, and then parking management. You know, some people would say, well, what's parking management have to do with traffic control? Oftentimes, people are parking too close to intersections. They're causing unsafe situations. And so we look at, you know, can by changing the parking in the area, can we improve safety? Can we improve traffic flow and make it safer for people to use? The more capital-intensive types of things involve actually physically changing the streets. People like to think of speed bumps. Speed bumps have fallen out of favor. They're more like speed tables or speed humps, raised intersections. a number of different things, adjustment of the alignment of the roadways, and things that physically change the road, forcing people to change their behavior while driving. And it's really, you know, you want it to slow people down and change the behavior of the speed. People speed because they're comfortable driving down the road fast, not because they want it, they're malicious or anything like that. But if they drive down a street and they're going 30 miles an hour, that's because most people are comfortable at that speed. If you speed too fast down Richards Avenue, for example, if you go 30 miles an hour, you think you're flying, because that's a very narrow street. But if you go out of outer Islington and you go 30 miles an hour, you don't think you're going as fast. It may not be appropriate speed, but the people who are driving feel more comfortable, and that's why they're driving at that speed. And that type of information is really important when we're thinking about solutions on how to do this. So these are just a list of types of solutions. We've done a couple of solutions throughout the city. Bump outs are things that my staff hate because it causes them difficulty when plowing, but it is very effective because it narrows the roadways. There are other types of things where you can physically obstruct the end of a roadway and turn it into a dead end. And there are a number of different types of things that we have out there. I won't go through the entire list, but when we come up with solutions to try to address traffic, these are the things we review, and this is what we're working on with residents when they come up with requests. And then finally, something that's been requested a number of times and we've been directed by the City Council to complete is to develop a neighborhood parking program for neighborhoods of the city. It's currently in development. We're working with staff and we met internally to talk about some options, and we'll be coming forward with a proposal for consideration for public input probably towards the end of November, so that we can get feedback, because in order for us to implement this by the completion of the new parking garage, which is scheduled to be completed by September of 2018, we need to have funding in place, because a neighborhood parking program requires enforcement, it requires additional signage, it requires additional staff, so there's cost implications to that. So I need to be able to develop those numbers so that we can bring them to City Council for the consideration for funding. So that's, in a nutshell, the status of the parking program, and at this point, we are at an end.
Sure. Great. Thank you.
Why don't I give Terry an opportunity to give a status of the wastewater treatment plant?
That'd be great.
Thank you. For those of you who don't know, the Pearson treatment facility out in Pearson is being upgraded. So the reason that this is being upgraded is to bring it into compliance with current regulatory standards. So it's a chemically enhanced primary treatment plant being upgraded to what's called secondary level treatment and for nitrogen removal. So the project was bid and awarded in September 2016 to a firm of Salem, New Hampshire called McEwen Construction. So they've been working on this project since that point in time. It began slowly, at least in terms of on-site work. There's a lot of project of this magnitude, there's a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes at the desk level. In the fall of 2016, however, they did start on site, and the first order of business was to get some of the traffic enhancements done for the traffic in order to accommodate the larger traffic that would be coming into the site down Marcy Street and Mechanic Street. So most notably, there was modifications made at the intersection of Marcy and Mechanic. We also made some enhancements to the pedestrian corridor, so there was a chain and post fence put up along the limits of Pierce Island. And then at that point in time, it was soon after that the construction company mobilized a lot of their equipment. We ended up closing off the island near the pool, and they began a lot of the work in the site. So as far as that work, you know, essentially it includes, they demolished a number of buildings already. They have built a new building. They're in the process of building the largest building on that site. And a lot of that is, concrete work. So a lot of the traffic that you see at this point is going to be pretty consistent in terms of the future here. So the project will be going on for quite a bit longer, and I'll talk about schedule in a moment. So this past spring, we did start to prepare for our first summer season. Obviously, this was a concern of ours, given the amount of folks that come to the island for recreational purposes. So one of the items that we did was enhance the parking. So we increased the size of the 4G Island parking lot. We made changes adjacent to the boat ramp area for additional parking. And we hired some ambassadors of sorts, parking ambassadors, to assist with helping people around the island during the course of the pool hours, really. and that seemed to be a successful endeavor. As far as the cost for the project, it was originally awarded at $72.8 million. There's been three change orders to date. So change orders on a project of this size are expected. We planned for that through setting aside contingency funds, and we've since, with those three change orders, increased it to $73.8 million. So from a cost perspective, we're about 35% complete. In terms of the cost that they, you know, just they bill us monthly for their work complete. So on average, we've been seeing about $2.5 million a month. The peak that we've seen is around $3.5 million for a single month. And again, a lot of that's just the concrete work that's going on. As far as schedule, the contractor is on schedule. So the start, September 2016, the secondary treatment system needs to be up and running by December 2019, meeting permit by April of 2020. And we have a project, what they call substantial completion, when everything except for the punch list type items is complete, of May of 2020. So from a schedule standpoint, we're about 30% complete. I just want to reiterate, in terms of our outreach, my information is on the city's website. I'm always available if anybody has issues or questions. We do hold monthly construction meetings on, I think it's the third Wednesday of each month. And those are at City Hall, 11 o'clock a.m. In terms of the comments that we've seen, the majority of the comments initially have really focused around one-way or wrong-way traffic. We did put a stipulated haul route. There have been a number of instances where the contractors, subcontractors, haven't necessarily followed the route. So they go out and they distribute pamphlets to every one of their subs. They've had meetings with them. We've been diligent about having them track their subcontractors and all the vehicles. When we do get, as a result of the initial complaints we got, we did put out video cameras. So we have video cameras on a number of intersections. So if we do get complaints of one-way or wrong traveling traffic, we can confirm whether that's associated with the construction project, and we have issued a couple of fines associated with that. We did get one other comments about safety, particularly at the intersection of Marcy and Mechanic. We've readjusted some of the stop lines, and we have been tracking that with the video cameras as well. In addition to the monthly meetings, we issue quarterly updates to the council, and also monthly updates to the EPA, all of which are available on the city's webpage. And again, my information is always, you can always call me if you have questions or comments.
All right, thank you, Terry. So at this point, we want to open it up to question and answer time. So Kathy Bergeron, I think, is going to come up and help with the microphones. We could, so we'd like to get in as many questions as we can, and many people be able to ask the questions. If you could state your name and address, please try and keep your question direct or as brief as you can, and then we'll get through what we need to. So I think with that, we can open it up. Do we have any questions? Yes, sir.
This particular board, certainly we've felt the pain of increasing taxes, and the question that I have for the department heads that have spoken so far is, what innovations are you making in your departments to reduce the cost, efficiencies to reduce the cost of your departments? Thank you.
When we put out our self-assessment in 2015, we had a number of recommendations as we went through that that we're implementing, and I don't have the entire list, but one of the ideas is it ranges anything from our capital improvement plan and adjusting purchasing. It also looks at just operational costs, where we can maximize those citywide. We've been trying to get similar contracts instead of having in our own silo, so we can leverage the cost of items, the cost of services. I know we're doing that with Public Works, City Hall, and the Police Department, and now I think the School Department on a number of issues. And I know that as we move forward, it is going to be a challenge of, I think we're at our fire department's at a point where over the last 5 to 10 years, we've been trying to trim and be efficient. It's in contrast to the demands for services. And that is my concern as not only a resident, but as a department head. I want my services to get better and not get worse. And I know one of our challenges with the development and the growth in the city is the fact that we're having more duplicate or simultaneous calls happening at the same time, and our calls are taking longer. And a good example would be if the smoke detector goes off in my house, my ranch in Elwin Park, one or two fire trucks can resolve that problem pretty quick. We go to a smoke detector activation in the downtown at Portwalk Place, it takes multiple units a longer time. And we've seen our response times increase or our times out of service, which may not sound like a lot, but when I got here in 2000, we were doing pretty consistent work around 5 or 6 minutes to get there and about 20 minutes to resolve problems. And incrementally, it's changing. So although we're looking for efficiencies, my concern is that the more efficient we get, I think it's starting to get to a breaking point where it may take us 1 or 2 minutes longer to get to the problem. And I think at a certain point, that's not going to be acceptable. So, but that document on our website lists a number of initiatives that and approaches we're trying to take against best practices to be more efficient.
From our end, I meet every 2 weeks with my budget manager for a minimum of, it's supposed to be 2 hours, we generally go about 3 hours. Everything that we buy, look at investigatively, whether it's, so for instance, we've looked at increase in, as the chief said, the amount of time we spend on domestic violence calls, the amount of time we might spend on sexual assault calls. So the first thing we do is we go to the various federal, state websites looking for grant money to assist us with when we, you know, those cases don't change overnight. They don't, they take time, but there is grant money out there. So we look at the grants first right out of the box so that we're not spending out of our budget, but trying to provide the exact same amount of services. Same thing as we're looking for equipment. When we're pricing things, we just were part, as you probably saw the article in the paper, it wasn't timing on our part. Our CERT team, which is a regional CERT team, was up training, which is the SWAT type response, and their entire training we covered with a grant. So it's, we try to look for funding outside. There was just a training that we were looking at dealing with labor relations issues. And you know, I've been in this business for 35 years, and it always seems that officers, detectives, supervisors find trainings that are in Miami and Las Vegas. And we found a very similar training that is to the labor training that's taken place in Boston. It's a 1.5 day training. So they can go for a full day down to Boston, drive back, go down for the half a day, drive back as opposed. And that's every single budget item. I can't say enough about Karen Senecal, who is my budget person. She is beyond amazing. And we try to give back money, and I think the assistant city manager can attest to that. We try to give back money at the end of every fiscal year, whether it's savings from salaries or savings in other areas, so that, you know, we're not overspending our budget. But as the chief said, and as I've told you here tonight, 10,000 more calls for service already this year. The opiate addiction is increasing, the time on these calls is increasing, the equipment, and we're doing everything we can to stay within budget. And we're not quite doing more with less, but we're doing more with the same. So.
Thanks, Chief. Mm.
Peter?
Sure. Thanks, Norm. That's a good question. So 4 years ago, I took over the department, and there was not a lot of good documentation in terms of operations. So one of the first things that we looked at was, you know, let's kind of revisit all of our assumptions in terms of how we're doing things. The first thing we attacked was the solid waste side of things. We had a really inefficient setup where we had more trucks and staff on the street than needed. So what we did is we ended up consolidating the routes and putting what appeared to be more people on the trucks, but we reduced the total number of trucks and the total number of people, and by doing that we significantly realized some savings. We also, this last year, we looked at the capital aspects of solid waste. The Packer trucks themselves are very expensive. They wear down very quickly. And so what can we do to help reduce the number of Packer trucks? Two Packer trucks are used at the recycling facility. They're just there static, idling, so that so residents can buy and throw their trash in them, because we didn't have enough compactors on the backside of the retaining wall. So the compactors are cheaper than the Packer trucks. So we, instead of buying two new Packer trucks, we bought three new compactors, eliminated the need for two trucks, and we're saving capital expenditure there. We've done some significant improvements relative to lighting. The recently replaced streetlights is a realization of $120,000 a year, and an additional reduction, significant reduction in carbon input into the environment, which, so it's a win-win relative to improved efficiency as well as the carbon associated with that. We've looked at a lot of cross-training. Historically, the department was siloed. You had the highway crew, you had the water crew, you had the sewer crew, you had all these different groups that kind of, like, we all need our own equipment, we all need our own operators, we all need these things. We break down those walls, and we said, this is silly. We're all one organization. The level of expectation from the residents, rightfully, has risen. You do not accept the old level of service that was provided. You want more for your tax dollar. So we made it clear to staff that we're going to be holding them accountable, and that we expect them to work together. And if one group is not working with another group, which causes us to have to do rework, which happened a lot in the past, that's unacceptable, and there'd be people held accountable. So those are the types of things that we really focused on. And you know, every year we go through the budget cycle. Budget, you know, people think, well, budget gets approved in April, May. We're currently working on FY19 right now. We have to look at the greenery that's been added to the city is beautiful. But the level of service required associated with that greenery is very different than what we've done in the past. We've added additional staff by sliding staff that was located in one area to another area. And we've used these tools that we've used, the Portsmouth Click and Fix, to gather that data to better understand where is the demand for service so that we can more efficiently move staff around. There are, you know, a lot of things we need to do. There's limited resources, we understand that, and there are hard policy decisions that City Council will need to be making on what their priorities are in the future. But we, you know, we're trying to gather information so we can make data-informed decisions so that the council, who makes, you know, ultimately makes the funding decisions, can be informed so they understand what they're spending their money on, so that we can provide the best service possible given the limited resources. So that's, in a nutshell, what we've been doing over the last 4 years.
All right, thank you. Kathy, you have the mic, sure. I'm going to do it here.
Good evening. My name is Sharon Lloyd. I live on Cliff Road. Just sort of a bit of a follow-up question I have. I'm one of those that does go to the recycling center. I try to recycle as much as I can, reduce the amount that's actually going into the landfill. We're a sustainable city. I'd like to have something discussed as to whether we've ever looked into doing a give-and-take barn. I've seen a lot of stuff going into those garbage trucks that are absolutely perfectly good, that they shouldn't be going into the landfill. And also, even if a give-and-take barn doesn't work, I know we're now having a nonprofit take all the bicycles, which is fantastic. Have we ever looked into other nonprofits, such as Operation Blessing, or Goodwill, or Habitat for Humanity, end up being able to have some sort of structures there that they could use for anything that really needs to be reused, not going to the landfill?
Sure. I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name.
It's Sheridan Lloyd.
Okay, thank you. So we are currently in the process of looking at a new transfer facility. Currently, if you frequent our facility, it's not really configured well. It's very space limited, and we were fortunate enough to be able to secure property in back of that area. It's the old Foundation for Seacoast Health property, which wraps around the Pike area, and it's a really great space, and we're looking at expanding that area. We did a request for proposals for consultants, and we're in the process of selecting a consultant to do the design for that new facility, which will make it much safer, much easier for residents to access the recycling, and it's going to include not a swap barn, but it was a I forget what we're calling
freebie
it.
Barn.
A freebie barn. It's a place that people could leave material and take material out. We are working also with the Rotary on medical devices, so that's something that's getting recycled as well. So, and we've done books and things like that. The challenge right now is we're very space limited, and it's the more complexity of movement in that area. I get very concerned about traffic in that area. It's not a great layout in terms of movement of vehicles, so I get concerned about too much activity. But we're very excited about being able to expand to a swap shop or a barn or something that's going to be able to allow people to one of the best things that used to be the large trash pickup, and it was kind of a free-for-all of the garbage, or not garbage, but fun stuff was left on the side of the road and everybody would circulate around town, and this would kind of be able to bring that kind of thing back. We can expand there now if we had the monies available. But as the previous speaker said, there's this limited resources. So we are programming it for 2020, which is July of July of 2019. The monies would be programmed for that. They'd need to be bonded and then constructed. So it's a couple years out. But there's a lot of things that go into doing a design properly, and we want to look at the whole site to make sure that we're taking into consideration the future instead of doing something quickly and not really thinking about the overall function that we may grow into over the next 20 years.
Thank you.
Let me take a question over on this side. Excuse me, sir. Is the microphone off, maybe? Is the microphone on?
Okay.
In your presentation, you didn't go over the Pleasant Street reconstruction. So if you could give me some timelines in terms of that.
Sure. I'm sorry. I should have highlighted that.
Yep.
I should have highlighted that project, because I know that's a... the question was, what's the timeline on the Pleasant Street our reconstruction project, and I know that's something that's been of high concern for the section of the ward five. We're completed the design. We had a public meeting. When was the public meeting, Terry? Do you remember? About a month ago. We got good feedback, and the design is finalized, or is in the process of being finalized. We're anticipating bidding it before Christmas, with the intent to start this spring. So. Things will start to happen on Pleasant Street in the springtime, and it'll be disruptive. I apologize right now in advance. So,
is there any more information available on timeline?
Well, the timeline is really it'll be a full season construction. So there'll be water, sewer, some drainage, sidewalks. It's a major construction project.
But you'll be publishing that timeline.
Yeah, before. Thank you. Before we start the project, once we have a contractor in place, we'll have a pre-construction meeting where residents will have a chance to speak to the contractor, get a point of contact with people, and throughout the project, we'll have a point of contact throughout the project on site for people to be able to speak with, to make sure their concerns are voiced. And really, the best way to minimize the impacts is for us to be aware of things that are going on. If there are special events, if you have a graduation, a wedding, a party or something like that, you need to forewarn us so that we can plan accordingly and try to adjust our schedule. Sometimes we can't. Sometimes things they just have to get done. But usually we can adjust our schedule and accommodate folks and help them out as best we can. So we will continue to communicate throughout the project. And before the project starts, we will have a public meeting that'll be advertised. And in the near term, if you want to stay on track or keep on top of what's happening with it, you can go to the website, to the city projects, and there's a write-up on that. It doesn't change really quickly. The best thing to do is if you have a question, you can call us directly and say, hey, what's the latest status? We try to keep the website up to date, but we have a lot of things going on, and it's a lot of information that, you know, you're seeing the people that, that do that updating as well as doing the work. So,
thank you. All right.
Sure.
Hi, Nancy Andrews, Sagamore Avenue. Tonight, several people alluded to the increased population, how many more people we have. Do we have statistics on, like, how many people live approximately in each ward, and what is the population of Portsmouth now, and what does our population swell to when we have events, because that's all impacting fire, police, public works, and, I mean, as a citizen, I've been here 47 years, and I've noticed a big increase in people, so that's an issue for me when we talk about what our budget is doing, what we're doing with our budget money. I think it would help us to understand as residents why some things might be costing more. But I don't know if you see that manager can help us.
I can try. I believe the latest population estimate is around 21,000. I know that during the daytime, when Pease is fully occupied with daytime workers, the daytime population swells to probably twice that. So Portsmouth actually feels like a much bigger city, more populated city than it actually is in terms of full-time residents. I don't know if we have that by ward. The data that we would rely upon would be census data, which is broken down by census blocks. So there might be a way of estimating that. To really get a hold of that. But one of the other interesting trends is that the overall household size in Portsmouth has been decreasing over the years. So even though, you can say that people, the same amount of people are living in additional units here. That's one of the trends that was observed as part of the Portsmouth Listens Housing Dialogue and part of the comprehensive plan, is that we can actually see that the household size overall is smaller than it used to be.
Thank you.
Next census is in 2020? Mm.
Sorry. All right.
Sure, go back.
Hi, Kelly Shaw. I'm on Banfield Road in Portsmouth. This is for Chief and Chief. Thank you for your service, first of all. I know we're getting bigger in size in the south end of town, Banfield Road, Water Country. I always have free on Water Country. One of my concerns is that we have a new ordinance in effect, and that is that no box trucks are allowed on our road, except if there's going to be a delivery. They have to go the long way around, and as a post office, trucks always have to go a long way around on Route 1, back down to Heritage, and then back out to Route 1, back around to Ocean, or go around to 95. Since the ordinance has been in effect, it's basically been ignored, even though Eric Eby has signs on Heritage Avenue. I spoke to Mayor about it. He had more police presence in place. I recently called again, and the dispatch I talked to said, well, they can go on the road. I said, no, there's an ordinance. They're not allowed on the road. And she said, well, they can still go on the road. I wasn't going to dispute it, and I figured this was a good time to bring it up. We're actually all of you guys together. We have construction work going on down the same paths down at the other end of the road. And from my understanding, we were told that they were supposed to be using Pebbly Hill to Route 1 to 95 or back down Ocean, and not to cut through on Banfield. We're still having a large amount of 18-wheelers and trucks on our road. They're not only just going on the road, they're speeding. We've asked for police presence at certain times of the day. We've been ignored. When I've spoken to a lieutenant some months back, we were getting into an email sparring about what is right, what's not right, what the traffic is. They don't live on the road. They don't see what is in the was the first. They don't go by actual what is actually happening at the time. And I'm very frustrated. I've been talking about this for 2-3 years.
It's the first meeting.
Some things have improved, though.
So first off, I'm not sure it was you, but about a month ago, I spoke with a woman on the phone relative to speeders on Banfield Road. Okay, no, and we.
Voicemail about 2 months ago.
Yeah, that was probably still Chief Mara's voicemail that I couldn't get into, unfortunately. Okay, but we addressed. I sent cars down there for the speeders, and I can tell you, I just made the note, and we will get down there and handle the problem with the box trucks.
It's like 5 in the morning, it's about 6 to 7-ish in the morning.
So early.
About 5 to 7-ish at night. And now that it's darker earlier in the morning, they're sneaking back out through, you know, just cutting through again. And they have, in Public Works, the sign's been up there for how long, Peter? For, you know, I don't know if
it's there. No, I do that
in
months.
I will take care of it.
Who's got the mic?
Sure, right here.
Thanks. Mary Lou McKelway, 259 South Street. I'm speaking in regards to the sidewalk ordinance for brick sidewalks, which are pretty prevalent in Ward 5. And for the walkers and the joggers in the area, the brick sidewalks are not as safe as the concrete and the new concrete sidewalks that have been put in on Junkins down south are not only good looking, but they feel a lot safer than walking on brick sidewalks. On South Street, our section of South Street, new sidewalks were put in maybe 13 years ago, 14 years ago. They're a mess. So as far as walkability within Ward 5, many of the streets are not because of safety. Even on a day when there's just a little bit of fog in the air, a little bit of mist, the sidewalks are very slippery. So I wondered if the brick sidewalk ordinance can be addressed for the certain areas in the historic district. Thank you.
Yeah, Peter, you win.
Could it be addressed? Yes, it could be addressed. Mary Lou, you are very much aware of the history, I believe, of the sidewalks and how we got to this point. I'm not sure exactly what it would take to change it. I know the way it's written right now, the ordinance says historic district has brick sidewalks, with the exception of a section of Islington Street. There is the possibility of using concrete in places, but it's right now it's the policy that we have in place. I don't think it's something that I can speak to and just say, you know, it's a policy decision to a certain extent, and I'm not sure I'm comfortable saying one way or the other that, you know, how it could be done. No, you're not. I think you need to bring it to, you know, to venues like this and make people aware of it. You know, it's something that's, there's an expectation that brick sidewalks are going to be placed in these areas. So, you know, I'm implementing the direction that I was historically given. It has modified a little bit to allow a little bit of flexibility out of the historic district, but not so much in the historic district. So it's a policy decision.
Yeah. So how would that get addressed, the policy change like that?
Well, obviously a policy decision would have to come to the city council. There would be an ordinance proposal followed by a public hearing and discussion to see if that policy decision needs to be changed or should be changed. So that's the way to bring it.
Can I ask for a show of hands who does not like the brick sidewalks?
Dangerous.
Okay,
dangerous.
Just checking the temperature.
We have to walk on the road, which when the traffic calming, it's issues.
Yeah, fair enough. Thank you. Okay.
Suggestion, there are different pavers that are not brick that have more grip and permeability to address some of
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Paige Trace, 27 Hancock Street. This is a question for everyone out there. 4th of July weekend, South End was a parking lot, and it scared the willies out of all of us there, because Chief Achilles and Chief Burnett, if either of the two of you had to come for any of us for any reason, you wouldn't have gotten to us. We were having block parties over there, watching the cars, and there'd be one car and move maybe 10 feet in 20 minutes. So my question is, obviously there was an article in the paper afterwards, and I'm just curious as to whether anything's been done with Garmin or whoever you deal with. I would guess, Nancy, it would be some sort of a GPS thing. Because you couldn't get to us. Fire, heart attack, and the entire South End was closed. So my question is,
I'll speak just from the response standpoint, and I know that being in town that weekend, it was exacerbated a lot by the construction. I mean, a lot of things. Without having the Sarah Long Bridge, I know that a lot of the ways in Garmin was taking people and going off the bypass, and I made the mistake of going on the other side and trying to get back into town. And basically, once you got to the Memorial Bridge, it was backed up because people were trying to go down Daniel Street. And then when that was stuck, they did the same thing. And actually, I got a call from our shift supervisor saying, you know, and we were trying to figure out if there was something going on the bridge that was any, like an accident that we could request state police on either end to start redirecting people. And that wasn't the case. It was, so I know that maybe other city people can speak to what could be done. But I know that we started putting plans in place for a couple days of what we would do to deploy resources in an area, because it seemed like it wasn't getting any better. But I know that, or at least I'm very hopeful that once the middle bridge opens up, that will take some of the pressure off the downtown again. Because, I mean, people going across the bypass split off and came into town and vice versa. So that's what we felt, and I understand, but I'll defer to other city people on that.
Well, we actually asked people as they were sitting there on the street in their cars, and universally they were being directed off at X3 and sent through the South End to the old bridge.
So just, you're absolutely right. There was a couple of things that helped us with the perfect storm too. It was 4th of July this year was like a 5-day weekend. So Saturday being the worst day of all for traffic, and it was the entire town. I probably failed it about 20 phone calls and maybe 20, 30 emails and text messages. And we did the same thing. We had the officers go down, try and keep an intersections clear as best they could, but we had them talking to the drivers, and they were being directed mostly, and not to pick one vendor, but Waze was directing them off of the highway into town. As the chief said, between the Sarah Long Bridge, the 5-day weekend, I know a lot of people that they talked to said, well, I didn't want to deal with it on Friday, so everybody left on Saturday, because I think the 4th was on Tuesday this year, if I'm not mistaken. So there was a combination of things. What we did is we did put a traffic plan together, and I think you're referring to the newspaper, and I made sure that we put additional officers on, all assigned, and again, to be fiscally responsible, we have step grants, we have crosswalk grants, we have hands-free grants. We put them all throughout the downtown area on the Labor Day weekend, and make sure we were keeping the intersections open, make sure we were keeping the off-ramps from backing up, which, you know, once one is blocked, you know, that ends the whole story. But it didn't, you know, it helped having the intersection kept clear, but on Labor Day we didn't have that problem. And I think it was a bit of the perfect storm that everybody was out on Saturday. It was the 5-day weekend. People were staying, you know, starting later, and Waze did direct everybody in town. I have not had any contact yet with Waze or Garmin or any of those things, and we can, Nancy, I can, she can address that.
Well, I want to point out that Waze doesn't know that the Memorial Bridge is a drawbridge either, so.
Good point.
Yeah, I know that I don't know specifically to the 4th of July, but I know that we have contacted successfully Garmin at least in the past to kind of get their routes adjusted the way that we think that they should be. I also know that our new parking director is working hard at providing wayfinding information on our website so that it's the first place that people would go to find out how to enter the city for various events and where to park and park and then walk, basically. So he's working on providing people with direction for various events. The last thing I just want to say is that I'm glad you made that comment, because now we can think about wayfinding when we're planning for large events in the city. Before any large event that you see happen in the city, a major planning process happens behind the scenes. So the requests for events appear before City Council. The City Council then refers it typically to the City Manager, and the City Manager assembles the entire public safety and DPW crew that will be involved in the event and invites the event chair people, so to speak, to meet with us and talk through all of the logistics. So without boring you with the details of that, I think putting on the checklist to be aware of how people get into the city for various events is a good suggestion.
Great, thank you. All right, Kathy, yeah, we'll bring it around. Who's over here? Josiah, sure. Then we'll bring it back through this group.
Thank you, Robert Mondale, 15 Pickering Ave. Just to follow up with you, I believe that the Prescott Park venues are maybe not applicable to that when there's a popular venue on that particular night. We just watched very, very, very seriously on Pickering Mechanic Ave when there's somebody famous. The other thing I'd like to guess for Blaylock is, and who is our liaison for Ward 5 in it? Okay, so when we have issues, for example, how do we reinvent the Pierce Island Blue Ribbon Committee? Why was that disbanded? There's so much improper use of that island right now that's just been turned blind. Created this no dog ordinance, which is crazy because everyone abuses it. The cars parked there, RVs parked there at night. There's businesses running out of there. No one pays for launching out there. Why have we allowed that thing to, or the remainder of Pierce Island to turn into such a wasteland and a serious loss of revenue?
So on your first question about the Blue Ribbon, the Pierce Island Committee, on request of the chairman and the vice chairman and their membership through the chairman, that they wanted to suspend their meetings because they felt with the construction of the wastewater treatment plant, really they were inhibited on really performing their normal functions. So it was on their request that they weren't just banded, they just suspended, because what happens is these committees have a term. In fact, Blue Ribbon committees expire at the end of every mayor's term. And to prevent them losing all their membership and having all their members' terms expire at the same time and not have a committee in place when the construction was over and it was time to kind of re-energize the Pierce Island. So that's the answer to that question. It was on the request of the committee itself that they were put in suspension. They still exist, they're just not meeting. They're not meeting at all. And what was your second question? It was on...
Well, there's a lot of abuse out there. Nobody's watching.
Right. So actually, that would probably be best addressed through the city manager's office and the Terry Desmaris, who's, you know, kind of in charge of Pierce Island now, especially the construction zone. Now, as far as the boat ramp the Fort Tree Island, that would still be under the jurisdiction of the city manager's office. So the as far as to my knowledge, the committee was more in place to kind of beautify the place, make decisions on keeping it user-friendly. But I think it, since it is still city-owned property and the boat ramp is still active, I use it myself. Fort Troy Island was just out there the other day. It's beautiful. But as far as the
residents don't have to pay, there are so many people who are out there every day. We're losing thousands of dollars of revenue every day out there. How do we arrive at some sort of audit as to why we are losing money for people that are not residents of this city?
I'm not sure I understand what you mean by losing money.
I've been dealing with it from the city manager's office all summer long.
So what revenue is it we're losing?
You're supposed to pay the launch boat. You shouldn't be running business out of there. There's five.
That would have to have the city manager address that, because I do not know. I know that when I went there to launch my boat, because I'm being a resident, so I get the resident permit by showing identification, and. I showed it to Perry. Perry was manning the shop at the day, on that day. So hold on, I'll pass it over to city manager.
Well, I don't have a specific answer for you, but we can talk, you know, after this session, and I can find out more and get back to you.
Isn't there somebody there?
Thank you.
Yeah, he was.
All right, guys.
Yeah.
Let's keep it in here.
Thanks, Doug. I'm sorry that you're under the impression that we sit and wait for something wrong to happen. There are examples of, you know, like the Andrew Jarvis intersection was an initiative brought on by city staff. That was something that, you know, is very important. The intersection that you bring up has been brought to the Parking, Traffic, and Safety Committee, I think, four times maybe, and it's been consistently voted to not pursue those types of things, because in order to enable a crosswalk at that location, you'd have to take away a number of parking spaces that are very valuable in that section of the city. There are crosswalks. Yes, they are a little bit farther on the other side that you have to walk down and then walk around, or you need to cut across at the section before you hit the island. But your point's a good point. We have tried, you know, as you said, we have embraced the tactical urbanism. I like to call it street lab, because tactical urbanism implies, you know, paramilitary ideas in my mind. But I think it's a really good thing, and I appreciate the input. You know, we take inventories, we do traffic studies, we're looking at traffic circulation in the entire city, we're creating a traffic model to be able to explore alternative means of traffic flow into the downtown. As you may recall, we've had a number of people say that we should open up some of the one-way streets to two-way streets, and in order to do that, that's a very difficult thing to do in terms of tactical urbanism. You really need to do a little proof of concept before you take on that type of thing. And so there are a number of areas that, you know, it's important for the residents to bring these things to our attention because, you know, we tend to look at the condition of the roadways. We tend to look at the difficult areas. There's a great, the end of Lang Road is a great example of a very difficult, dangerous corner. We're working with the state and hopefully going to secure some monies to push that project forward so we can get an alternative route behind the Service Credit Union to get to the signalized traffic, the intersection on Ocean Road, to make that intersection to turn, so you can turn left, going south, to be a safer intersection. So I guess I may not be answering your question specifically.
I guess the difference is that the Alumni Drive and Highways, these are very expensive construction projects, whereas you could do something inexpensively with paint and poles and that sort of thing very quickly to address these problems right now. And you can find out if those solutions work rather than designing the exit from the high school to, which is a, you know, many years process.
Sure. And one example, you know, we didn't, you know, do a full-blown reconstruction of the intersection of Pleasant and Court Street when we put in the four-way stop sign, because it really needs drainage improvement and needs bump out. So we're waiting for the Pleasant Street job to do that. So that's an example of the city actually taking on that approach. And you're absolutely correct. The challenge for us, and Norm would be, if he's still here, would be appreciative of this, is, you know, we have limited staff and we have a lot of things that we're working on in addition to just these types of things. And so we have to prioritize when we're doing these types of things, and we go for the safety types of things. Banfield Road is a great example of a very challenging road that needs improvements. The culverts down there are very dangerous, and we've been working hard to get to those things. Kelly has been, you know, a dogged advocate for it, which has been great. But oftentimes some of these challenges are capital intensive. You know, we're receptive to doing, you know, the tactical urbanism, the street lab types of things, but we don't, you know, there are a lot of things that we'd like to do and we think about, but oftentimes the initiative for experimentation isn't always appropriate to be coming from city staff. So.
Thank you. All right.
Hi, Catherine Lamont, 84 Haven Road. I was not here at the beginning, and maybe you addressed this. I live right there in the Little Harbor School neighborhood near Jack and others. And we've noticed that an increased amount of activity at Little Harbor School on the weekends, walks, this walk, the Alzheimer's walk, the whatever walk, starting at sometimes 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning, loudspeaker, loud music, lots of activity. Stop me if you've already talked about this, but how do these...
We did not.
Okay. I'm just wondering, you know, again, in this issue of sort of just feeling like the constant presence of people and noise when you're trying to, you know, have a peaceful life on a Saturday morning. How do these events get, are they like evenly distributed across the city? And do they ever go out to Pete's or kind of to a less congested neighborhood? I don't know. You know, if the walks have to happen through the South End so frequently, and the other events that are often located at the these things used to happen at the middle school, they seem to now all happen at Little Harbor. So, if you could offer any input on how the decisions get made and who I talk to.
I can let the mayor chime in as he will. But generally, the process for requesting an event comes to the city council for approval of that. They refer it to the city manager's office to coordinate all the event details. From my experience, there's no way that events are evenly distributed throughout the community. Most of the events want to happen downtown. And for the sake of public safety coverage for police and fire, many of the events now, we suggest that they take a prescribed route rather than create their own route. For the ease of having established details and where the ambulance locations are, et cetera, we try and keep people on sidewalks, you know, if possible. I'm not sure about the history question as to how Little Harbor is being affected more now than at other times.
Yeah, I can help with that. Because I live, like, right there, and I've actually gone out and asked them to turn the loudspeaker down until the thing actually starts, you know, and oftentimes you'll start at 10 if it's a walk, but they may be music blaring from a pretty loud speaker as early as you said at 8 o'clock. I do know historically that almost everything used to start at Little Harbor School. Once that became the go-to place, once they wanted to do everything to the south end. And I know that there's been effort through the city manager's office with John Bohenko to get some of these things to move to Red Hook. There's been a couple of things that have moved out to the Pease area where they would start from Red Hook maybe, or just the last weekend there was a bridge walk that started the Memorial Bridge. So I think you're right. There should be an effort to kind of spread them out, middle school on occasion, so that we're not hosting the beginning of a walk, run, or some sort of fundraiser. They're all worthy causes. And if they are going to start at Little Harbor, which is a quiet neighborhood, as you mentioned, and a congested neighborhood, we can get backed in if at the beginning of something. To have it, as the chief said, we're managing the traffic so that we're not blocked on for too long of a time, and having the volunteers and have a specific route that's, you know, maybe designed by the police department in conjunction with the city manager's office. So I know that anecdotally, there's actually fewer events than there used to be at Little Harbor because there was so many that there was an effort made, I think, through complaints from the neighborhood, and this goes back several years, to spread them out a little bit. But it seems like everybody wants to begin their fundraising walk in our idyllic little neighborhood.
Thank you. All right. Sure.
Joanna Burrow, I live on Mechanic Street in South End. And I just wanted to add to you, there was a day last year when my husband and I had to get into Boston, and there were, I don't know how many runs going on, but we absolutely could not get out of town. It took us close to 40 minutes and we got to we tried South Street, we tried.
Actually, how many runs?
So whoever is coordinating.
The City Council directed us to come up with a plan to develop a resident parking program. I'm not sure which ones you're referring to, but we looked at a number of them. Our parking director is the point person on this project. We have, but what's important is that one size doesn't fit all. You know, what works in one community won't necessarily work in this community, and one what works in one neighborhood may not work the same in another neighborhood. So what we're looking to do is try to develop something that has flexibility, that allows the maximum input by the residents so that they can have some level of control in terms of what they want to do. As you probably know, when you do a neighborhood resident parking program, if friends come to visit and they happen to not have parking stickers, they could be subject to being towed or ticketed. So there's a level of involvement from the residents that's necessary so that they understand the implications of taking on this parking program. There's many examples of it working throughout the country, so it's not like we're reinventing the wheel. And we're looking at, you know, bringing that forward once we've internally looked at it to make sure we've looked at it from all angles and tried to come up with cost impacts associated with it, because we don't want to commit to something and then say, oh, yeah, well, we didn't realize it was going to cost this, and then, you know, all of a sudden there's that, and we have a budget constraint. What's that? Signs, and yeah, there needs to be a way to monitor those stickers, correct? So typically, what we're finding is people use what are called radio frequency ID tags, so that a staff person can go by with a wand or a measure that says, yep, that's the right location, this person is appropriate, they need to be there. You can't just put placards and things like that in windows because they're too easily replicated. So signage is going to be necessary, so people need to understand if they are in a specific neighborhood and what the restrictions are associated with that. Many programs have unlimited time for residents and limited time for non-residents. They have nighttime restrictions for non-residents, but not daytime restrictions. So there's a number of different approaches to this, and we don't want to make assumptions that, you know, this is the right size and the right thing for your neighborhood. We want to make sure we gather the information and then come present it to you and then get some feedback, get some input. But our goal is to have, or our directive is to have this in place by the time the next garage is open. So we are moving forward with this, and, you know, we're planning on having a program for consideration. Absolutely. And that's the intent of a neighborhood parking program, is to alleviate those types of things. Mm-hmm. Yep. You may have noticed we had recently adjusted some of the parking down near right on the corner of Gate Street. So there was some improvement there. But your point's well taken, and it is something that, you know, it is something that the neighborhood's been asking for. So we are bringing it forward.
Thanks. And just we've had the same issue come up from other parts of the city too, like by Islington Street in that neighborhood. You can imagine they're also suffered some of the same things. So I think you're not alone.
Thank you. I don't want to put Peter on the spot, but in conjunction to the resident parking program, we also simultaneously have to look at a downtown employee parking program as well, because that's who's parking on the streets in front of your homes a lot of the times, but they do need a place to park, and they need an affordable place to park. So those things are in conjunction with one another, and so that's one of the reasons why it hasn't happened already. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of background work.
This is a question for the microphone. Donald Coleman on 122 Mechanic Street. My issue is really directed towards members of the City Council, the mayor, and the city manager's office. I'm listening more and more discussion tonight about services. I've heard the fire department, I've heard the police department, I've heard public works justify the increases of budget and say things cost more and more. Well, the issue really, I'm not questioning that, the issue really becomes after a while, the city is expanding. The city isn't expanding in its permanent residents. It's expanding in the industrial, it's expanding in the commercial, it's expanding in these very, very large building projects, downtown and other residential building projects scattered around the city, which puts a much greater demand on the services of the fire department, public works, police department, and so on. And with the increasing assessments for the residences and the decreasing assessments, so to speak, proportionally in the commercial area, I would think at some point City Council may want to consider a temporary moratorium on further building large commercial structures, certainly in the downtown area, certainly in Ward 5, but perhaps across the whole city, until there can be some type of a study or an adjustment based upon the greater demands on the city budget, by the people that don't live in Portsmouth, that may come to visit Portsmouth, that might be transient, but there really has to be a reckoning at some point. We were told in the newspapers, and we were told with applications to various departments in the city, for instance, planning department, and maybe not HDC, but the zoning department, with regard to, we're going to have some more commercial buildings, there are going to be large structures, that's going to help support the budget in Portsmouth for the residents. Well, that has turned out to be absolutely false. It isn't true. So my question really would be, isn't it time that the city council, the mayor, planning departments, and the office of Mr. Bohenko really start to take a look at what the additional costs are to the residents of Portsmouth for all these extra services, for the new buildings going up, for police, for fire, for protection, and so on. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great question and a big question. Would it be fair to look at how the impact of services and things like that are factored in to the cost of commercial development in the town? Do we feel like they're keeping up and that there's a balance there?
I'll take it first. I agree with you. I think the growth of Portsmouth has been mostly in the commercial sector. I mean, we're seeing bigger buildings. I mean, I grew up in Portsmouth, I remember a day where we didn't even have a downtown hotel, and it was all residential property taxes. We had very little, the economy was quite different. And we always enjoyed pretty good city services. So with the recent assessment, it has come to light that, I'm in a unique position because I own a home that's, tripled in price in the past 12 years, which means my taxes have gone through the roof on my home. I also own a small commercial building on the waterfront on Siri Street, the old Ferry Landing restaurant. And even though it's gone up, it hasn't gone up nearly as much. So this recent assessment, my taxes will go down a small amount. Are the services required at my home equal to the services required at a restaurant that serves 75,000 people a summer? Absolutely not. We should be paying a larger share. So if there was a way in the state of New Hampshire for the city of Portsmouth to put extra tax on commercial enterprises to recover the more expense we need for our services, as you heard from the fire chief and you'll hear from the police chief, the more people visiting Portsmouth, we have probably 50, 60,000 people in Portsmouth on a daily basis. That requires a lot of services. It should not be all on the backs of the residents. And, I'm not a financial genius and can figure out how do you structure a revenue source that is not totally based on what our actual land and homes are worth, but on what the value of the commercial enterprises and if we find a way to tax that. And I really don't know the answer to that, but I think that's the way we have to go. Because certainly, every time we, in order to decrease the budget at this time, we really have to lay off people. Because most of the budget is salaries and benefits and healthcare and such. And that's 85% of the budget. So there's no, the difficulty is how do we reduce services without reducing our quality of life? Well, I don't think we can. So I think the goal is to find more revenue from the commercial sector, which is increasing the demand for these services. So I'm in complete agreement with you on that.
So and that's why I suggested for the time being that you need to figure this out, whether or not it's going to be the same.
That's something that should be part of the conversation, absolutely.
And there should be a moratorium on building any more of these structures that we as residents have to support.
That should be part of the conversation.
We're having it right now.
It's starting now, I think, and at the city council level. So as you know, there'll be a new city council in place in January. There's an election going on now. So this is the time to voice that to various people running and seeing what can be done. I don't know the legalese on what can and cannot be done with a moratorium on private property. I mean, you know, in this country we have strong private property rights. And if someone owns a parcel of land, how can we tell them not to build on it? I don't know the answer to that. There must be a way, though, to lessen the impact of the commercial on our services without them having to pay their fair share.
If it's okay, I know there's a lot to that question, and probably more that we need to go through. I want to be aware of the time, and I want to make sure people will just take 10 more minutes, and I think we want to wrap it up. So how many people have not been able to ask a question? All right, so let's try and get to these few here, and then I think we'll try to wrap it up from there.
Feel free to chime in, but we actually do have a very active planning process for sea level rise. So I would refer you specifically to Peter Britz, who works in the planning department, but he spearheads our efforts with respect to sea level rise. There's been a recent grant that has been implemented to, in fact, inventory all the properties that are likely to be affected by sea level rise in this area. So that's in place. We are also having another committee work on a different grant right now, and two of our staff people are about to go to a conference in Maryland to actually speak to the topic of sea level rise in historic districts in particular. So we are actively planning for that right now.
Thank you. Yes?
Hi, my name is Janine McCoy, and I am fortunate enough to live on Marcy Street here in Portsmouth. And I wasn't planning to say this, but if anyone wants to stay afterwards, I have some really creepy pictures of myself last November when I took a tumble on one of the concrete sidewalks in town. So, you know, I think our footing on all of our sidewalks is challenging sometimes. But what I wanted to say, I've been sitting here for 2 hours and my head is spinning. And this is what the city officials and city employees do all the time. And I just wanted to thank the people who came out here tonight, the citizens, but also to ask everybody to give a round of applause to the city employees and the city officials who, you know, one thing is for certain, our demands and needs and wants and what we're looking for from the city is not decreasing. And I just really appreciate this forum tonight and the realtors that supported it. But also, I just want to ask everybody to thank our city and state officials for and the civil servants for what they do, because it is oftentimes, I think, like Sisyphus, you know, you're just never going to meet all our demands. So I wanted to say thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. And we got time for one more. Do we have that? Sure.
I'm Harold Whitehouse, and I'd like to address a question to either Peter or the project manager over at Pierce Island Treatment Plant. Either you, Peter, or the project manager there.
But what's the question first, then?
The question is, they'll be demolishing a building at the treatment plant, very sharp, according to what I hear. Now, there's a plant in that building that was dedicated in 1965. I hope that doesn't end up in somebody's trophy room or end up in the dump. That has some significant names on that plaque, and it should be part of Portland, and those names were the instrumental of getting the city turned around in the direction it is today. So please, save that plaque, make sure it doesn't go to the dump. Thank you.
Yes, and the plaque will be saved along with the, there's two plaques actually. There's a building that was built in the 90s, and there was the original one from the 1964, I think it says on the plaque. But both of them will be saved and put in the new building.
Great, thank you. Okay, thank you everybody. I think we went a lot longer than we were planning to, so I wanna wrap it up and give you a couple minutes if you wanna talk to people individually. Thank everybody on the panel for coming out for the evening. Thank you all for coming out and spending time here, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.